the Fleischman Feast Hour, presenting a variety entertainment directed by Rudy Valley.
Time is your time. Your time is my time. Hi-ho, everybody. This is Rudy Valley and Company. I'm very proud of the company we've assembled for tonight's show. It comes closer, I think, to meeting our ideal requirements than any group we've brought together on this stage in recent months. For name value, news value, and performance value, we give you tonight Mr. Cole Porter, the man of the hour in the songwriting world. Singing the song everyone is talking about, You're the Top, from Anything Goes, the biggest musical comedy hit of the year.
William F. Hart,
the well-beloved movie star of Another Day, emerges from retirement to be with us tonight.
Miss June Walker,
who will appear with Henry Fonda and Ralph Riggs in the current Broadway hit, The Farmer Takes a Wife, by Mark Connelly and Frank B. Elson.
Buck and Bubbles,
leading Negro comedy team on the current vaudeville stage.
Miss Beatrice Lilly,
who always finds a hearty welcome here whenever she returns from London.
Hey there, I'm Mike Gillett, your host, and this is When Radio Ruled, Episode 5, 1934. A look back at popular radio and American life in the year 1934.
Extra, five-star final, all the latest news, terrific, gigantic, colossal, marvelous, tremendous, stupendous, magnificent, unbelievable, you're sensational, you're the headline in my heart, you're the thing that makes it start to beep, you're sensational, well I'm those electric charms, just to tingle in your arms is sweet, 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 sweet. You are the queerest kind of a dearest kind of a hoodoo dear. You make me do the things that I shouldn't do, but I do, do, dear. You're sensational. You should win the Nobel Prize for the way you hypnotize this blase heart of mine. Poor guys in this world, and they are terrific. There are poor guys in this world, and to be specific, they've a mighty reputation. They are leaders of the nation. Maxie Bear, da-da-da, you're okay. You just won your big fight for the USA. You thought looked like a gag, but when we saw Canaris and we knew the fight was in the bag. Mr. Dionne, man alive, folks have one kid, but you had a half child. Eddie Cantor is a dunce, he had one at a time, you had five at once. You're the kind of a guy Mussolini wants for. Mr. Winter, Walter Winter, it's a pincher, little pincher, you're okay. You write your columns full of spice, some are naughty, some are nice. You walk in the good, but stay in the mice on Broadway. President Roosevelt, President Roosevelt, with the time full, we have your part. You're sensational, you should win our Nobel Prize, for you made us realize you're great, 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 great.
1934 was year 5 of the great worldwide financial depression. Things were still bad, but in America there were glimmers of hope. Franklin Roosevelt had been president for only a year, but his policies seem to have stopped the economic freefall inherited from President Hoover. The gross national product actually increased by 7.7%, and unemployment dropped to a still sky-high 21.7%.
This is a great national crusade, a crusade to destroy enforced idleness, which is an enemy of the human spirit generated by this depression. Our attack upon these enemies must be without stint and without discrimination. No sectional, no political distinctions can be permitted. It is time to provide a smashing answer for those cynical men who say that a democracy cannot be honest, cannot be efficient. Never since my inauguration in March 1933 have I felt so unmistakably the atmosphere of American recovery. But it is more than the recovery of the material basis of our individual lives. It is the recovery of confidence in our democratic processes, our republican institutions. We have survived all of the arduous burdens and the threatening dangers of a great economic calamity. We have, in the darkest moments of our national trials, retained our faith in our own ability to master our own destiny. That faith is receiving its just reward. For that, we can be thankful to the God who watches over America.
For the lucky 78.3% with jobs, the average income was $1,600 a year. In 1934, a gallon of gas cost 10 cents, a loaf of bread, 8 cents. The average house rent was $20 a month, and if you wanted to buy that average house, it would cost you $5,970.
Chevrolet offers every motor car buyer and every winner in the contest his choice of 11 big six-cylinder models priced from $445 to $565 FOB Flint, Michigan.
The U.S. government had been very active over the previous year, but there were still disagreements about whether or not such activist government was desirable or even constitutional.
This week, number one old dealer Herbert Hoover and the cabinet's most radical new dealer, Secretary of Agriculture Henry A. Wallace, go before the country with magazines for megaphones in the sharpest conflict of political philosophy since 1932. Hoover with his challenge to liberty in the Saturday Evening Post, Wallace with his tyranny of greed in Collier. On NRA codes, old dealer Hoover.
Today in the United States, the whole philosophy of individual liberty is under attack. Spur to the whole process of code making has been to impose the code by means of the threat of depriving our citizens of their business and their livelihood.
New dealer Wallace.
When the codes were fixed up under NRA, businessmen came to Washington by the thousands, anxious, eager to make codes. In fact, many of them hoped through these codes to put their competitors out of business.
On regimentation of business.
Over all small businesses in every town and village, every day in the week, is now the daily dictation by government of how men are to conduct their daily lives.
By the use of our new rules over business, it is possible to direct, stimulate, restrain, and balance our economy so we do proportion the national income for the greatest good to the greatest number.
On Old Deal versus New Deal.
At Lexington, at Valley Forge, at every step on the western frontier are the graves of Americans who died that the human spirit might go free.
The pioneer path of the American people came to an abrupt end in 1914. The old order is played out. A new one, with new rules, must be arranged. And if the rules are not changed fast enough and in the right direction, the American game will break up in a riot.
The Republicans, the few that remained, spoke against FDR, but were only talking to themselves. Everybody else was with FDR. He seemed to be fixing the economy.
And our
problem was, of course, the banking situation. Because, as you know, the banks had collapsed. Some banks could not be saved, but the great majority of them, either through their own resources or with government aid, have been restored to complete public confidence. This has given safety to millions of depositors in these banks. Closely following this great constructive effort, we have, through various federal agencies, saved debtors and creditors alike in many other fields of enterprise, such as loans on farm mortgages and home mortgages, loans to the railroads and insurance companies, and finally, help for homeowners and for industry itself. In all of these efforts, the government has come to the assistance of business, and with the full expectation that the money used by the government to assist these enterprises will eventually be repaid. I believe it will be.
There was opposition, of course. Louisiana's political boss, Huey Long, was positioning himself to run for president in 1936. And Catholic priest Father Charles Coughlin founded the Union for Social Justice, which self-funded a popular syndicated national radio show featuring Father Coughlin preaching against predatory capitalism, banks, communism, the Jews, and Roosevelt.
What was that?
A rock, Your Honor.
I know it was a rock, but who threw it?
Here he is, Judge. I've seen him break your window. Here's the trick.
Good work, officer. Well, a left winger, hey?
Who wouldn't worry? Look at, there I am, a year old and no hair yet.
No what?
Oh, are you starting again? Hair. What's on your head?
A policeman's club. I'm a communist.
Play, Don. The next two jokes don't look so good.
What's a communist, Jack?
I'll tell you later, Mary.
But the opposition couldn't shake FDR's popularity among the common American people. FDR had saved the banking system, and therefore the economy. The revolutionary fire that seemed to burn so hot when Hoover was president was now under control. All it took was a president who convinced the struggling Americans that he truly cared about them.
I'm happy to report that after years of uncertainty, culminating in the collapse of the spring of 1933, we are bringing order out of the old chaos with a greater certainty of the employment of labor at a reasonable wage and of more business at a fair profit.
General Johnson on President Roosevelt.
I want to tell you that if there is such a thing as national luck, Uncle Sam was carrying a hat full of rabbit's feet when the country elected Franklin Roosevelt to the president.
President Franklin D. Roosevelt completes his first year in office. Millions of men go back to work. America once more faces forward. Strike up the band!
Let the drums roll out. Let the trumpets call. Let the people shout. Strike up the band!
Hear the cymbals ring, calling one and all to the marshal's swing. Oh, say, can
you? Yankee Doodle went to town.
Say, can you?
Way down south in the land of cotton.
Say, can you see that there is work to be done? There's a war to be won. Come, you son of a gun. Take your stand.
With our flag unfurled,
we can face the world.
March, men, and all of them back to work again.
All of them back to work again with jobs, machines, work, pay.
Look, Paddy Avery, Jimmy and Ty are here to fight. Cannot die.
From the plains to the hill, from the farm to the mill.
Come on along, let's go.
Italy. Premier Mussolini levies 50% tax on all bachelors. Single men venture opinions behind closed doors. Mr. Garibaldi Monte.
I got a no job. I got a no wife. I got a nothing. But I got to pay 50%. There's a no place like a Rome.
Sylvester Galuppi. Man about what's left of town.
Shoo, 50% of tax. Married man got a better half. Single man, he's not got a quarter. I'm lucky I got a black shirt. I got an odor sent to the laundry.
On the international front, 1934 was a good year for hate, oppression, and fear. There were more dictators and more communist and more fascist governments springing up all over the world, including Bolivia and Brazil. Stalin ordered the Great Purge, arresting thousands of his own citizens for show trials and conviction.
You say the Count is accused of not killing Rasputin?
Quite so, Your Honor.
It's a very serious charge. Call your first witness.
Very well.
Japan withdrew from the Washington Naval Treaty of 1922 and the London Naval Treaty of 1930 and began to openly increase the size of its navy as fast as it could. In Italy, fascist Benito Mussolini was firmly in control thanks to his secret police. He was an oppressor to his own people, but internationally he was very popular. That would change, as we will see in future episodes of When Radio Ruled.
There's one fella, Mussolini, I'd do anything in the world for. Except play cards with.
You wouldn't play cards with Mussolini?
No, not me.
Well, why not?
With Mussolini, a deuce is higher than a king. And not only that, but I gotta tell you, Mussolini is a great inventor. He's invented a dress that shows the boys if a girl pets.
A dress that shows if a girl pets?
Yeah, V-neck.
V-neck. Burl, how did you ever get on this program?
I don't know.
All right, Ben, Milton is here by my invitation. In fact, I demanded him.
Rudy's right. I'm here BVD, by Valley's demand.
Hitler kept busy in 1934. Through laws and official acts, he institutionalized anti-Semitism. To consolidate his personal power, he ordered the Night of Long Knives, a bloody purge that murdered some high-level Nazis along with the leading opposition politicians. When German President Hindenburg passed away on August 2nd, Chancellor Hitler assumed the powers of both offices and declared himself Der Führer. His propaganda machine then went to work, presenting Hitler as a god to the German people.
Berlin, Germany. From Ernst Hamstangel, 1909 Harvard graduate, and now Adolf Hitler's publicity agent-in-chief, goes a letter to James Bryant Conant, president of Harvard University.
Dear President Conant, it is my profound conviction that my years at Harvard have given me incalculable advantages. I have decided, therefore, to offer the sum of $1,000 to be known as the Dr. Hamstangel Scholarship to enable an outstanding Harvard student to spend 1 year in Germany, 6 months to be spent in Germany's art center, my native city of Munich, the remainder in any other German university. This, to my mind, fittingly symbolizes my perennial love and affection for Harvard, Boston, and New England. Sincerely yours, Ernst Hamstangel.
Back to Berlin to Nazi Hamstangel. This week goes a reply from President Conant.
Dear Dr. Hamstangel, although the Harvard Corporation appreciates your generosity as a Harvard alumnus, they have voted to decline your gift. We are unwilling to accept a gift from one who has been so closely associated with the leader of a political party which has inflicted damage on the universities of Germany through measures which have struck at principles we believe to be fundamental to universities throughout the world. Very truly yours, James B. Conant.
Back in the USA, we were doing our best to ignore the obvious inevitability of war. We were focused on more salacious news, like the arrest of Bruno Hauptmann for the kidnapping and murder of the Lindbergh baby 2 years earlier in 1932.
Bruno Richard Hauptmann, you are indicted for extortion, suspected of kidnapping and murder.
I am innocent.
For 2 years, an aroused nation has sought the kidnapper and murderer of Charles Augustus Lindbergh, Jr. Then a fortnight ago, Bronx police arrest Bruno Richard Hoffman, carpenter, one-time German machine gunner. Bronx County indicts him for the extortion of the $50,000 Lindbergh ransom. But still, the state of New Jersey and the nation wonder, does the evidence prove Hoffman committed the kidnapping and murder?
The handwriting on the first ransom note, left on the windowsill of the baby's room the night of the kidnapping, has been identified in the criminal laboratories of the Department of Justice as your handwriting.
I do not know anything about it.
In your house was found a German-American dictionary, with the pages turned down where appeared the most difficult words in that note found on the crib.
I am innocent.
The ladder used to enter the Lindbergh nursery was constructed from lumber taken from a lumber yard in which you once worked.
I do not know. I was never in Hopewell.
A keg of nails exactly like those which held the ladder together was found buried in the earth of your garage.
I know nothing about it.
It is believed that the person on that ladder wrenched his leg when it broke. You limped on a bad leg all the summer after the kidnapping.
It is varicose veins I had.
Your footprints correspond to the imprints left beneath the baby's window that night.
I am innocent. I know nothing about that.
On the night of the kidnapping, did you meet a man named William C. Dennis on a road near Hopewell? And did you borrow from him a tire pump? That man claims you did, Bruno Hoffman.
I never saw him.
A chisel found near the Lindbergh home bears the same trademark as the tools found in your garage.
I know nothing about it.
Bruno Richard Hoffman, in a trunk in your house was found a detailed roadmap of the country around Hopewell.
I know nothing about it.
Do you know, Bruno Hoffman, that whoever received the ransom money identified himself by two special pins taken from the baby's crib and a child's blue sleeping suit? Do you know that $49,000 out of the $50,000 of ransom money have been traced to you?
The man Fish, who died in Germany, gave me the money. I am not guilty. I will be able to explain everything. I know nothing at all about the Lindbergh kidnapping. I am a decent man. I ask the world to withhold its judgment until the case is over.
Unbroken by 16 days of grueling examination, undaunted by circumstantial evidence which draws tighter and tighter around him its accusing web of facts, Bruno Richard Hoffman stubbornly reiterates his innocence. As the now bewildered nation watches the law's battle against his armor of silence, the New York Law Journal pronounces,
before Hoffman can be convicted of kidnapping and murder, many links in the chain of evidence against him are still to be forged. Lacking a confession or betrayal by an accomplice, the only crime concerning which proof is apparently complete is an offense with which he is not likely to be charged, that of hoarding gold.
Bank-robbing murderer John Dillinger became a national folk hero when he broke out of prison, locking up his guards before escaping. Legend has it Dillinger whittled a block of wood into a realistic-looking gun and used it to bluff a guard into giving up his keys.
Have you done anything about Dillinger?
Have I? Listen, I'm leaving jackknives and pieces of wood on every street corner in the country.
For what?
The minute Dillinger comes out to whittle, I've got him.
However Dillinger got free, his subsequent series of daring crimes captured the public imagination. Dillinger would show up in seemingly random places, take whatever he wanted, and disappear again into the great expanse of the Midwest, only to appear later in another unlikely town to commit another crime. Dillinger's sightings were reported from all over the country, making it seem that Dillinger was everywhere.
Flash! Dillinger seen simultaneously in several cities throughout the country. Boston, Massachusetts.
I came home unexpectedly last night. I heard a noise in my wife's closet, and it might have been Dillinger, so I didn't look.
Berkeley, California.
My husband woke up this morning and missed 80 cents from his pants pocket. I convinced him it was Dillinger.
Miami, Florida.
I was out fishing today, and something pulled on my line, but it got away. Might have been Dillinger.
Somewhere in America.
This is Dillinger.
These reports from different parts of the country is on the level, folks. That's me all over.
Law enforcement seemed completely helpless to stop Dillinger. This became a source of comedy material for the radio funny men.
Well, the question box still has no word from Dillinger.
Give me that letter, will you? There it is, Frank. It says, Jack Benny, care front of Ritz-Carlton Hotel, New York. It's funny how people find out where you're living. It says, we'll be listening to your program Sunday night. Please ask Frank Parker to sing home again and find John Dillinger.
John Dillinger?
Yes, it says John Dillinger, FRD7, Iowa, Illinois, Nebraska, or where do you think? Just a man about town. I think we better answer that. Mary, take a letter. Mr. John Dillinger.
USA?
Or Canada. Dear sir, if you will send us a 3-cent stamp and your address, we will be glad to mail you a copy of this song.
Is that all, Jack?
That's all. Sing, John. I mean, Parker.
Warsaw, Indiana. Dillinger holds up local police station and escapes with bulletproof vest and ammunition.
Stop it! There he goes!
Shoot him in the pants. He's got on a bulletproof vest.
Shots a clean getaway.
The local officer tells what happened.
Well, folks, he just busted in, made himself a hum. Didn't have much to say, but what he did say was potent.
Are you sure it was Dillinger, officer?
Yes, sir. Positive. When he took his gun out to my back, I was full of splinters.
That's Dillinger.
Of course, the Dillinger joke stopped after the FBI filled him full of holes outside Chicago's Bijou movie house. All in all, 1934 was a lousy year to be a high-profile gangster. By the end of 1934, John Dillinger, Bonnie and Clyde, Pretty Boy Floyd, Bugs Moran, and Mad Dog Underhill were dead, along with dozens of lesser-known criminal associates.
I'm so pathetic that I always have found it best, instead of getting them off my chest, to let them rest unexpressed. I hate parading my serenading as I probably miss a ball. But if this city is not so pretty, at least it'll tell you how great you are. You're the top, you're the Coliseum, you're the top, you're the Lou Museum, you're a melody from a symphony by Strauss, you're a Bendel Bonnet, a Shakespeare Thomas, you're Mickey Mouse, you're the Nile, you're the Tower of Pisa, you're the smile on the Mona Lisa. I'm a worthless check, a total wreck, a flop. But if, baby, I'm the bottom, you're the top. You're the top. You're Mahatma Gandhi. You're the top. You're Napoleon Brandy. You're the purple light of a summer night in Spain. You're the National Gallery. You're Garbo Sally. You're cellophane. You're sublime, you're a turkey dinner, you're the time of the Derby winner. I'm a toy balloon that's made it soon to pop, but if baby, I'm the bottom, you're the top. You're the top, you're an arrow collar, you're the top, you're a Coolidge dollar, you're the nimble tread of the feet of Fred Astaire, you're an O'Neill drama, you're Whistler's mama, you're Camembert, you're a rose, you're Inferno's Dante, you're the nose. of the great Durante. I'm a lazy lout that's just about to stop. But if, baby, I'm the bottom, you're the top. You're the top. You're the Swanee River. You're the top. You're the goose's liver. You're the boy who dares challenge Mrs. Bear's son, Max. You're the Russian ballet. You're Rudy ballet. You're phenolac. You're romance. You're the steps of Russia. You're the pants on a Roxy Usher. I'm just in the way, as the French would say, de trop. But if, baby, I'm the bottom, you're the top.
Many people say that you cannot successfully sell two different products on the same radio program, but I don't agree. And that is why I have persuaded the Bristol-Myers Company to try this full-hour show. I know that if we bring you an hour of smiles and melody each week, you'll surely remember the two famous Bristol-Myers products, not one, but two products, Ipana and Salapatica, are making this entertainment possible. And I know that you will be more than willing to hear what we have to tell you about them for our mutual benefits. And now Theodore Webb, or Teddy, as we call him for shorts, when we call him for shorts, Ted Webb and the Salapatica Singers will give us Wagon Wheel.
The economy was still pretty bad nationally in 1934, but the radio business was more profitable than ever before. Revenues were up by over 20% industry-wide and more than 25% among the networks. Not coincidentally, advertising agencies were also thriving by buying up airtime for their clients, because anyone who wanted a product sold to the general public had to advertise on the radio. Because, by 1934, radio was firmly established as the most important source of information and entertainment in America. There were radios in almost every home and over 500 radio stations in America to listen to. Because radio was big business, the government decided to regulate it, establishing the Federal Communications Commission, also known as the FCC.
News and helpful information from Dr. R. E. Lee, Director of Fleischman Health Research. Dr. Lee.
Thank you, Mr. Wallington. A good complexion is not only a social asset, it's a business asset as well. For a clear skin means good health, pure blood, and a body that is free from poisons. Clinical tests on hundreds of patients show that eating the new XR yeast clears the complexion in an amazingly high percentage of cases, and in comparatively short time. These clinical results have been confirmed by thousands of people since this new yeast became available. Every day I receive letters from people who have quickly gotten rid of the ugly marks of poor health by eating Fleischmann's XR yeast. It is an entirely new strain of yeast, far stronger and much quicker acting. It normalizes your digestion and rids the body of waste. Your blood becomes purer, and instead of carrying poisons that irritate the skin, it brings pure nourishment that helps your skin make and keep itself well. To get the quick benefits that Fleischmann's XR yeast can give you, you should eat it regularly, 3 cakes a day. You should soon not only have a clearer skin, but also feel a great deal better. Thank you.
In 1934, there were two competing business models for radio stations, network and independent. The networks dominated the ratings. There were two that pretended to be three. NBC was the big gorilla, running two different networks of programming, NBC Red and NBC Blue. This allowed NBC to have double the stations in each marketplace, to reach more listeners, and increase efficiency of business operations as one office sold advertising time for both networks, and the same facilities were used by both networks to produce their programming. NBC Blue would sometimes just appropriate hit shows from NBC Red.
President Roosevelt takes country off the gold standard. Three goldfish turn gray overnight. Ah, but there's nothing to worry about, folks. It merely means that the money is being equalized all over the world. For instance, the French franc is now worth 4.5 cents. but the Coney Island franc is still a nickel. The German mark gained 1 point, while the four Marx brothers dropped two and are now on the air as a team. Now, the Swiss franc, if you care for combination sandwiches, has gained 90 pounds and is now 21 cents. But if you prefer a plain Swiss, it'll be 10 cents as usual. Of course, this condition will mean inflation. So the English pound will be 3.89, Sophie Tucker will be 2.65 and 5, and Paul Whiteman will be back to 2.90.
But the Chevrolet still remains 4.45, making it the best buy ever offered to the public.
You said it, Howard. Play, editor, play.
In 1934, Jack Benny was abruptly shifted from the Red Network to the Blue Network and changed his Sunday night time slot from 10 p.m. to 7 p.m. In this new time slot, Jack Benny shot up to number 3 in the ratings. Jack Benny would never again change time slots because Jack Benny was now the biggest star in America. The Jack Benny Show would endure to dominate 7 p.m. Sunday's time slot until Jack voluntarily left radio to focus on his television career.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am here tonight on behalf of the readers of Radio Stars magazine to thank Jack Benny for a decision he made 2 years ago. At that time, if you remember, although comedy was comparatively new to the air, many of the stage's funny men had already been lured to the microphone. Jack Benny in those days was reluctant to go on the air. If he failed to please, he stood to lose much of that prestige he had built for himself by years of painstaking performances before visible audiences. It was one of those perplexing crossroads to which many of us come. Jack Benny took the one marked radio, and that is the decision for which I want to thank him tonight. Once each month, Radio Stars magazine is privileged to call public attention to outstanding radio programs and performers. We do it by means of a medal called the Radio Stars Award for Distinguished Service. This medal has never before been awarded to a comedian. But the listeners of America, who are the readers of my magazine and, in the last analysis, my bosses, have directed that this month we draw attention to the finest show of its sort on the air. So, to you, Mr. Benny, and to your able fellow fund makers, Mary Livingston, Frank Parker, Don Bester, and Don Wilson, and Harry Kahn, your writer, we say thanks, and we present you now with Radio Stars Magazine's Award for Distinguished Service to Radio. Good luck and good fun always.
The other network, the scrappy little network, was Columbia. It had many fewer stations than NBC and consistently got creamed in the ratings by NBC. Columbia would have a golden period after the war because of their quality programming, but not in 1934. In 1934, Columbia was the weak sister network.
This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
In 1934, Columbia did show NBC they meant business when they convinced Eddie Cantor to jump from NBC to Columbia. At NBC on the Red Network, Eddie Cantor's corny jokes and musical stylings were rated number one in 1933. At Columbia in 1934, Eddie Cantor's show didn't appear near the top of the ratings, but he was well compensated and remained Columbia's biggest star for years.
Mandy, there's a minister handy, and it sure would be dandy if we let him make a fee. So don't you linger. Here's a ring for your finger. Isn't it a humdinger? Come along and let the wedding chimes bring a happy time for Mandy and me. I was strolling out one evening by the silvery moon. I could hear somebody singing familiar tune, so I stopped a while to listen. Not a word I wanted to miss. It was just somebody serenading, something like this, my pretty Mandy. There's a minister handy, and it sure would be dandy if we let her make a fee. So don't you linger, here's a ring for your finger. Isn't it a humdinger? Come along and let the wedding chime bring happy time for Mandy and me.
The radio networks controlled only a third of America's stations. The other two-thirds were still independent local radio stations, some because they preferred to control their own destiny, but most because they were in a city where other stations were already network affiliates with exclusivity in their market.
It isn't the principle of the thing with me, it's the money.
The networks were feasting on profits. NBC Blue and NBC Red networks, combined with the Columbia Network, controlled 184 of America's radio stations, only a third of the nation's total. But the networks made almost half of the profits in radio. The other two-thirds of the radio stations, the independents, were more than a little bit jealous. These stations had stayed away from network affiliation, but they wanted to make network-type money. So it was just a matter of time before some stations affiliated themselves as a loose syndicate, sharing programming and advertising revenue.
Before saying goodnight, ladies and gentlemen, we want to congratulate station WLW Cincinnati. In only a few moments, WLW will begin to broadcast with 500,000, a half million watts, will become the most powerful broadcasting station in the world. More than ever, the nation's station. Now, good night until next Wednesday. Good night, and keep smiling.
The Mutual Broadcasting System was born in 1934 with four strategically placed radio stations: WGN in Chicago, WXYZ in Detroit, WLW in Cincinnati, and WOR Newark, whose broadcast signal covered New York City. These four stations began broadcasting as Mutual on October 2nd, 1934, with the instant hit, The Lone Ranger.
Fiery horse with the speed of light, a cloud of dust, and a hearty high-o silver, The Lone Ranger.
The Mutual Network would continue to grow and would become an influential part of the radio landscape.
And this postcard marked return in 5 days comes from Mr. Manuel S. Lehrfeld at Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Mr. Lehrfeld says, quote, "There comes a time in the life of every man when he has to make a momentous decision. Either he grows old with a scalp that looks like the husk of a honeydew melon, or he buys a toupee. Which do you advise?" Unquote. I am glad that you have brought this question up, Mr. Lehrfeld. Many men ramble through their 50s and 60s trying to get by on one hair.
They part it and try wearing it as a pompadour until the hair tires of it all and kisses the scalp a hurried goodbye in self-defense. Hundreds of white-collar men today owe their white collars to dandruff. I advise a toupee. Always remember, with the toupee, it isn't the upkeep, it's the overhead. And if perspiration on the forehead is any criterion, the man with the toupee is the hottest man in town. If you are in the market for a scalp doily, look well. Look well before you make the down payment, because the chances are you'll look just horrible afterwards. If you distrust my advice about covering your head with one of these wind-blown poultices, ask the man who combs one. Think it over, Mr. Lehrfeld, and remember that old saying, it's here today and gone tomorrow. Mr. Lehrfeld.
In the Crossley radio ratings of 1934, NBC dominated again with its two network strategy. The NBC Blue and NBC Red networks were really one big network, sharing facilities, talent, and sometimes programming. But by structuring as two networks and presenting two different program schedules, NBC had twice the presence in every city in America and could sell twice as much advertising time. Of the top 10 shows in the ratings for 1934, NBC ran the table. 8 shows from their Red network and 2 from their Blue. Fleischman's Yeast Hour, starring Rudy Valley, was number 1. Jack Benny's Jell-O program was number 3. Fred Allen came in 4th with his Hour of Smiles program. Ed Wynn, the fire chief, was number 6, and Amos and Andy were number 10. The other, smaller network, Columbia, doesn't appear in the ratings until number 16, The March of Time.
The March of Time. Tonight, the editors of Time, the weekly news magazine, raise the curtain again on their new kind of reporting of the news. The reenacting of memorable scenes from the news of the week. From the March of Time.
In the ratings' top 25 shows, Columbia also had Gulf Headliners, starring Will Rogers at 19, Burns and Allen at number 22, and news commentator Boak Carter at number 24 in the ratings. For those of you keeping score at home, in the top 25 shows, NBC Red placed 15, NBC Blue 6, and Columbia 4. Mutual wasn't represented at all. The number one show, moving up from 5th place the previous year and replacing the Eddie Cantor show at the top of the heap, was the Fleischman's Yeast Hour, starring Rudy Valley on NBC Red Thursday nights at 8.
What do you go for? Go see a show for. Tell the truth, you go to see those beautiful days. You spend your dough for bouquets that grow for all those cute and cunning, young and beautiful dames. All dames are temporary flames to you. Dames, you don't recall their names, do you? But their caresses and home addresses linger in your memory all those beautiful days.
Passé News, sees nothing, shows all. Abyssinia, Africa. Local wits dance, discuss arrival of prominent American tourists.
Say, Sambo, who that lady I seen you with?
That wasn't no lady, that was Mr. Info.
In 1934, the United States was a blatantly racist society, and the popular entertainment reflected that racism. Radio was entirely nonchalant about mocking African Americans.
I gotta do all my hitching in the daytime. Nobody can see my thumb at night.
Where were you all day?
Well, I was
was up in Harlem trying to get some colored eggs.
And of course, not just blacks, but most minorities were ridiculed. The Scottish, the Irish, Russians, Mexicans, Jews, and all other immigrant types were fair game for radio bigotry.
Hey, first one got a laugh. Tokyo, Japan. Tokyo, American baseball players, including Babe Ruth, arrive here and play Japanese teams. The battery for Japan was Dizzy Osaki and Daffy Matsuyama. In left field was Hackie Wilson, and on second sacky was Frankie Fricky. All good Japs.
During the war years, the dehumanization of the Japanese enemy would be much more intentional. But as this Jack Benny routine of 1934 demonstrates, that dehumanization didn't start with Pearl Harbor. Besides the disregard of non-whites in the audience, radio, like the American society, was totally sexist. But of course, sexism didn't start with radio. Just as radio's attitude towards blacks was rooted in the minstrel shows, radio sexism was inherited from show business conventions that preceded it. In the vaudeville world that was the training ground for vast numbers of radio artists, there was a popular female comic type called the Dumb Dora. A Dumb Dora was a ditzy woman who had her own bizarre view of the world. Usually she appeared in a comedy team with a straight man. The straight man tried to be the voice of reason, but was inevitably swept away by the Dumb Dora's comic logic.
Drive an automobile to America. Oh, you wouldn't catch me driving a car across the ocean unless I was sure the tires didn't leak. And then another.
Well, all right, don't worry about it. If you did drive an automobile across the ocean, about every mile, you would probably find a service station.
Oh, well, I'm not worried about that. What I'm worried about is there's no hot dog stand.
Hot dog stand?
Yeah, my dog Herman loves hot dogs. And I love my dog Herman. And George, if you love somebody and that somebody loves hot dogs, you'll drive farther for a hot dog than you would for a service station. Or would you?
Gracie, your dog Herman is not with us.
Oh, well, then let's take the boat.
Yeah, let's take the boat.
Sorry, madam, but you'll have to hurry because this boat goes to America in 5 minutes.
Oh, now that's what I call speed. A big boat like this going to America in 5 minutes. That's a
fast boat. Come on, Gracie, there's the whistle.
Gracie Allen was the greatest of all Dumb Dorers, but there were others. Portland Hoffer on the Fred Allen Show, for example.
Oh, hello, Portland. What are you doing in Hollywood?
Papa and I had to come here for a few weeks.
Why?
Well, Papa's sun lamp blew a fuse, so Papa said as long as we had to get our sun direct, we might as well come to California.
That's fine. I thought perhaps you were here to get in pictures.
No, I'd rather eat 3 times a day.
Well, don't you think movie actresses eat?
Not according to the fab magazines. They're always on diet.
Oh, not all of them.
No, Mae West and the Three Little Pigs look good and healthy.
Do you think dieting is injurious?
I'll intimate when my Aunt Lily broke her engagement, she went on a diet for 6 years.
What happened?
Well, the fellow wanted his ring back, and her finger was so fat it wouldn't come off.
What? What did she eat? Pineapple and lamb chops?
I'll say, my Aunt Lily ate so much pineapple, she walked with a hula-hula accent.
Did the lamb bother her?
Oh, yes. She was acting sheepish around the house, and she couldn't sleep night.
Well, she should have counted men jumping over fences.
Aunt Lily used to dream she was a lamb chop, and she couldn't sleep unless Mama put some green peas in bed with her.
Oh, that's terrible.
I'll intimate, when she got to putting those paper bloomers on, Papa made her go off the diet.
At about time, I should think.
On the Jack Benny Show, Mary Livingston started out as a Dumb Dora, but her character evolved into a smarter, more worldly woman, until Mary completely shed all vestiges of the Dumb Dora type. This new character better served the unique comedy of Jack Benny.
To see you back. Where were you?
Washington, Mary. We were just talking about the bankers' convention down there.
I'll bet it was cute.
Yes, it was cute.
You know, Jack, I don't think money is safe any place anymore.
Why, Mary, there's nothing to worry about these days.
That's what you think. I had money in the bank 5 years ago, and there was a run on the bank.
Why don't you keep your money in your stocking?
What good is that? There's a run in that, too.
Oh, so you do keep money in your stocking. Does it draw interest?
No, I wear a long fur coat.
Oh.
In a Dumb Dora act, the Dumb Dora was who everyone laughed at. With Jack Benny, it was Jack who served as the butt of most jokes. A Dumb Dora wasn't required. and Jack's comedy was more cerebral than the setup, punchline formula George Burns wrote for himself and Gracie. It served Jack's comedy much better to have a foil smarter and wiser than himself.
See, Jack, I think you'll just be swell in pictures.
Do you really think so, Mary?
Sure, there's always room for another Boris Karloff.
But I'm not a Karloff, Mary.
No, but you're certainly Boris.
Oh, is that all?
But in general, on the radio in 1934, women were considered less than men. And a lot of radio comedy was based on those silly women trying to act like men.
Miss Daniels and Mr. Lyon offer tonight a comedy sketch by Mort Lewis, a playlet which considers in a vein anything but serious the problems which may arise in the future if women continue to take the place of men as family breadwinners. The time, 20 years from now, in 1954. The people, Diana Travers, a tired businesswoman. And George, her husband. And since this is 1954, her housekeeper. George is waiting for Diana to come home from the office. The baby is proving troublesome. Ben Lyon and B.B. Daniels.
Oh, will you stop bawling until I get this thing folded? Where are those darn safety pins? Oh, here they are. Rock-a-bye, baby, on the treetop. Junior, dear, put daddy's watch down. Put daddy's watch down, Junior, dear. Put daddy's watch down, dear. Put it down. Oh, now look at my watch. Oh, you act just like your mother when you do that. Now, hold still, Junior. Hold still. Oh, dadum, sick little ookie pookie wookie with a bad little safety pin. Well, Daddy's very sorry. Just a minute. I'll bet that's your sweet little mommy. Now, you lie still while Daddy opens the door for mommy. I'm coming. Oh, didn't I tell you that was your sweet little mommy?
The door, why do you take all year to answer it?
Maybe you think I haven't anything to do.
You make more fuss over the little things you have to do at home than I do slaving at the office all day.
Little things? Why, do you know what I did today? I scrubbed the kitchen floor, went marketing, put up the preserves, had an argument with the grocer, and then the plumbing broke, and I had to send for the plumber.
I suppose that ice woman was here, too.
Oh, now, don't be sarcastic. I washed Junior's clothes, and... Oh, Junior was so naughty.
Well, darling, when I'm making a little more money, we'll hire a nurse for Junior.
Nurse, nothing. What that kid needs is a night watchman.
You know, I hate to say it, George, but I think it's a little your fault, too. You don't know how to bring up a baby. You don't mother him enough.
Mother him? Say, I don't mind scrubbing and cooking and washing dishes for you, but I'll be darned if I'm going to run ribbons through my nightshirt to fool the baby.
Why, George, Travis, I'm surprised at you. Why, you almost talk about your own son as if you hated him.
Hated him? Oh, why, Diana, of course. Why, I love Junior. Oh, everything's gone wrong today, and I'm just a little cross, that's all. Hey, Junior. Why, Junior's as sweet as... Why, do you know what he did today?
What?
He actually said a word.
He did? What did he say?
He said oompa.
Umpha?
No, dear, umpha. It's a cross between mother and father. You know, umpha mother and fa for father.
Umpha. Oh, you just let your imagination run away with you.
Imagination? So you think your baby didn't say umpha? You probably think he's too stupid to say umpha. There you are, taking sides against your own flesh and blood.
Oh, I didn't say anything of the kind, George. I just said that.
Yes, I know what you said. I have ears, and all that I can say is you're a fine mother taking sides against your own baby. Why, you didn't even say hello to Junior when you came in.
Oh, I'm sorry. Hello, Junior, dear.
He said it! My baby!
Oh, darling, I have a big surprise for you and Junior. I made a big sale today and got a whopping commission.
Oh, that's wonderful, darling. I'm going to give you a big kiss for that.
And I didn't forget you, George. Guess what I bought you?
Oh, Diana, not a...
Yes, an electric washing machine.
Oh, you darling, an electric washing machine. Oh, what more could a man ask for?
Well, there's nothing too good for my little husband.
Well, darling, since we're on the subject, I have a little surprise for you, too.
Oh, you have? What is it?
Oh, you are like all the other wives. You never notice anything. Don't you see I'm wearing a new suit? How do you like it?
Well, turn around. I don't like it. The pants are too long.
Oh, but darling, the boys are all wearing long pants this year.
Well, maybe I'm a little old-fashioned. But I liked it better when the boys wore knickers and showed a little more of their legs. And you have such nice legs, George.
Well, as long as you like my legs, well, maybe you'll like this.
What's that?
A bathing suit.
A bathing suit? Why, the bathing season is over.
Yes, but it was such a bargain, I just couldn't resist it.
Why, George, it has no top.
Of course not. None of the boys are wearing tops this year.
Well, you're one boy who's going to wear a top. You think I want all the women on the beach staring at my husband?
Why, it's the very same kind of a suit that Jim Morse wears.
That's all right for Jim Morse. He does a lot of things I wouldn't let my husband do.
Well, I notice you look at him hard enough when he comes on the beach. And I want to be just as attractive as the other boys.
Well, anyway, you're not going to wear it.
Oh, don't you think just because you're making the money here, you can order me around?
Either that bathing suit goes back or there's no washing machine.
No washing machine?
No washing machine.
Oh, well, all right, dear. Come on, honey, sit down. I've cooked your favorite dish for you.
Oh, I'm not hungry.
Oh, so you stopped at the club again and had a bite.
Oh, by the way, I won't be home for dinner tomorrow night either.
Oh, business again, huh? Well, this time I'll go to the office with you.
Oh, no, you won't. You'll keep your nose out of that office. Remember, a man's place is in the home.
Oh, I suppose that good-looking stenographer of yours, Henry Maxwell, will be there again.
Oh, stop henpecking me. There you are, being jealous again.
Jealous? If I ever catch that fellow taking dictation from you while sitting on your lap, I'll break him in two.
Now, don't be silly. My relations with Mr. Maxwell are purely a matter of business.
Yes, I know his kind. Monkey business. He doesn't buy the expensive clothes he wears on the salary he's making. I'd better not catch you after I've given you the best years of my life.
Were those your best?
Oh, sarcastic again. Well, if anybody has a right to be sarcastic around here, I have. Not you. Some good times you've been having. Monday night to a prize fight. Tuesday night to a turkey's bath. Last night out on business, and business again tomorrow night.
Wait a second. I haven't said anything. But you've been having a pretty good time yourself. You've been out to 3 bridge parties this week.
Oh, so you're going to throw that up to me? Oh, what do you expect me to do? Sit cooped up in the house all day waiting for you to come home? A man's entitled to play bridge once in a while as recreation from housekeeping.
All right. Let's not quarrel, honey. Say, what's that sticking out of your closet?
Where? Oh, that. That's nothing, dear.
Well, maybe it's nothing to you. But it looks like a woman's skirt to me.
Oh, it does, doesn't it? Oh, but it isn't Diana, really.
What's her name?
What? Whose name?
The woman you have hidden in that closet. A traveling saleswoman, I'll bet.
A woman? Oh, why, darling.
Don't you darling me. Open that closet.
Oh, dear, please, don't.
Oh, while I've been working hard at the office, trying to support you and our baby, some other woman has stolen your love. Open that closet.
I won't.
Open that closet or I'll break it down.
Oh, all right.
Why, it's just a dress.
Yes. I took that money you thought I lost at bridge and bought a dress for your big Christmas present. Now you've spoiled everything.
Oh, darling, George.
Don't touch me.
Oh, I'm a thief. Will you ever forgive me?
Oh, well, what a husband's for but to forgive.
There, dear. Wipe your eyes. What time is it?
7:30.
Oh, well, I better be getting back to the office.
Oh, back to the office again. Do I have to sit up alone another night waiting for you to come home?
Oh, I know it's rather hard on you. I've got it. Here's a dollar. Why don't you call up Fred Lewis and the boys and go to the movies? You can leave the baby with the Smith.
Oh, all right, but I'm getting sick and tired of being a neglected husband. Here, dear. Here's your coat.
So long, darling.
Oh, wait a second. It might be for you. Hello? Hello? Yes? Oh, it is. I see. Yes, I'll tell her. Goodbye.
Who was it?
That was business. I mean your stenographer, Henry Maxwell. He said he'd be 15 minutes late for the theater tonight.
Oh, let me explain, dear.
Explain. You made your last explanation to me. Give me my baby.
George, where are you going?
Where am I going? I'm going home to Father.
Thank you. Well, where in the world can I find a pair of the new May West corsets?
Straight rear, madam.
Not straight rear. I said May West.
Oh, round in front, madam.
Oh, thank you.
Where do I get...
Radio in 1934 America was a welcome distraction from the troubles we faced both home and abroad. As a business, radio was growing. New players were rising up to challenge the supremacy of NBC.
You'll love me someday, so why not now?
As an art form, radio was getting better. Radio practitioners like Jack Benny and Franklin Roosevelt were learning how to play the microphone like a musical instrument. And radio was transforming America, bringing it closer together through a shared popular culture and marketplace of ideas. Radio had quickly grown to become a unifying force for the American people, and it was a unity they would need throughout the great national trials ahead. And now we've reached the point in the podcast where I shut up and play a radio show in its entirety. Originally broadcast on October 3, 1934, an episode of Mary Pickford Dramas entitled The Church Mouse.
The makers of Royal Desserts present Mary Pickford and Company. Tonight's play, The Church Mouse. This is a great moment in radio history. We are bringing to the microphone tonight the best-known woman in the world. Her charming, familiar face has flashed on screens in every city and town in America and in Europe, in China and in Japan. She is a friend through her pictures to millions of men, women, and children whom she has never seen. We take pride in presenting Mary Pickford for her first radio series. She will appear each week at this time as the star of some well-known play. A play of real dramatic interest which has been tried and found successful on the stage. For her first appearance tonight, she has chosen the romantic comedy, A Church Mouse. In it, she will play the part of Susie Wayne, a girl whose honesty and sweet charm win for her first a job and later something even more important. She will be assisted by the following members of her company who will appear in the order named: Mr. Gail Gordon as Schuyler Thompson, Miss Jeanette Nolan, Mr. Theodore Osborne, Mr. James Eagles, and Mr. Crawford Kent. But before we begin the play, I want Mary Pickford to speak to you as herself. Ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor and a privilege to welcome to our studio, on behalf of the radio listeners of the world, Mary Pickford.
Thank you, Mr. McIntyre. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm trying something new tonight, just as I tried something new when I made my first picture. I hope it will be a success. May I thank all of you who've been my loyal friends for the support you've given me in my work. And I do hope you'll like me on the air.
This program is sponsored by the makers of Royal Desserts. When you dip your spoon into a colorful, sparkling strawberry gelatin dessert, you expect to taste the flavor of strawberries. And what a disappointment if you find it flat and insipid, with no strawberry flavor at all. But that's just what happens when gelatin is allowed to get shelf stale. You see, the flavor of gelatin evaporates when the gelatin gets stale. Stale strawberry gelatin loses its flavor, just as fresh strawberries do when they become stale. After a package of gelatin has been sitting on the grocer's shelf for a long time, the flavor is almost gone. That's why Royal gelatin is handled as a perishable food. It's rushed to grocers fresh by the same rapid delivery system that carries Fleischmann's fresh yeast and Chasen Sanborn's dated coffee. Royal has no chance to get shelf stale. When you buy Royal strawberry gelatin, It really tastes like delicious, fresh strawberries. And the other royal flavors are just as full-bodied and true to the fruit. Lemon, lime, orange, cherry, raspberry, or pineapple. Try Royal Gelatin tomorrow.
Wall Street. Skyler Thompson has made himself president of a big international banking firm at the age of 35. But though he has a genius for finance, Skyler is also human and has human weaknesses. In fact, he's so human that this morning he's had to dismiss his pretty secretary, Dolly Fry, simply because she distracts him from his work. Girls like you are for the evening, he tells Dolly. They've no place in a bank. No more women in my office from now on. So Dolly gets 6 months' salary, Skyler gets her telephone number, and settles down to work. But after about an hour, the door behind him swings noiselessly open and a tiny girl, pale, shabbily dressed and looking thoroughly frightened, squeezes into the room like a mouse. She tiptoes to Skyler's desk, waits for him to look up, and finally, she speaks.
Good morning. May I...
Who are you?
I...
How did you get in here?
I waited until the man at the door turned his back for a second, and then I slid through.
Why do you want to see me?
Because you're the president of the bank. You are, aren't you? You're Mr. Skyler Thompson?
Yes, I am. And who are you?
Susie Wayne. Oh, just nobody at all. But I had to see you. May I sit down?
Yes, but be brief.
I'm a stenographer. I want a position.
What?
Please give me a job.
I'm sorry, but you've come to the wrong place. I discharged my secretary this morning, and I intend to engage a man. That's all.
You mean that I'm to go?
Certainly I do. You've already taken up a great deal of my time.
I know, and I'm very sorry for that. But, I'm not going.
What?
Oh, I couldn't give up so easily. It would be cowardly. I might cry and try to work on your feelings, but I won't cry. Why, this very morning, the President of the United States is holding an investigation of my affairs.
An investigation of your affairs?
Yes.
What do you mean?
See, here it is. In the Times, an investigation of the problems of the unemployed. I'm that problem. I am the unemployed.
Yes, I suppose you are.
But if the president doesn't solve my problem by noon, he won't have anything to eat today and nothing tonight or tomorrow morning either.
Why, that's unbelievable.
Why should you be surprised? I've already told you I'm poor. What? I'm as poor as a church mouse.
Are you serious when you tell me you're often hungry?
Hungry? Oh, that doesn't describe it. I belong to the poor who press their noses against windows. You've seen girls look in windows, haven't you?
Yes, that's jewelry.
Well, I'm a delicatessen looker. I flatten my nose against the show windows and imagine I'm eating the delicious articles of food.
Why, you poor child.
For lunch, I look at frankfurters and potato salad. And then comes dinner.
Dinner?
But dinner's not so simple. I take a sardine and divide it.
You divide a sardine?
Mm-hmm. The tail is the appetizer. While I eat that, I look at trout and salmon. And then I turn my attention to the roast beef or to the fried chicken. In the meantime, I've eaten 2/3 of the sardine. I divide the rest into small bits. A little fruit and a little cheese.
And you want to work?
Work? Oh, I'll say I do. Look, Mr. Thompson, there's an empty table and a wonderful typewriter. Oh, it's such a temptation. Let me sit down and use it. You won't be sorry, because once I get hold of a machine like this, the work will fly. Dictate to me. Oh, please dictate to me.
Well, all right. Take this. Directors, General Oil Importing Company, Vienna. Gentlemen. At this time, I can inform
you... Faster, please.
...that the negotiations with the various European oil concerns...
Faster, yes.
...have been so successful as to practically assure my great project. After the fulfillment of the usual legal requirements...
Faster, much, much faster.
This transaction, which we consider of the greatest importance to the industry, can be completed on the 24th of this month in the city of Paris. Very truly yours.
Done.
Yes. Well, Emma...
Hello? Yes? This is the office of the president. You would like to speak to Mr. Scarlett Thompson personally? Oh, I'm sorry, but Mr. Thompson's not in just now.
What? You told them I wasn't in?
It was the safest thing to say.
And may I ask how you presumed to reach that conclusion?
It was a woman's voice.
Huh? Remarkable.
Now, Mr. Thompson, isn't it time to sign your mail?
Hmm? Yes. We'd better get that done.
Hello? Oh, yes. Just a minute. Do you speak to Mr. Frank Thompson?
Oh, my brother. Yes. I'm to have lunch with him. Hello, Frank. Yes, I'll be right with you.
Oh, Mr. Thompson.
This young lady here won't let me go till I've signed my mail. She's a human dynamo. No, she's not Miss Fry. Of course not. The young lady who answered the telephone is, my new secretary.
Oh.
Yes, I'll be right up.
Oh, you mean it? You're going to let me?
Well, that's taken for granted.
Oh, that's marvelous.
But I wonder if you'd mind, just for today, if I had lunch first and signed the mail afterwards?
Well, all right, but just for today.
Thank you. Well, I'll see you later, Miss Wayne. Oh, I almost forgot. How could I have overlooked such an important matter? Miss Wayne, I'm pleased to hand you a $10 advance on your salary.
Oh, Mr. Thompson. Oh, you're so kind. Well, I wonder if I may...
Well, what is it?
I would like to make a very important telephone call.
Oh, go right ahead. I'll leave you to yourself.
Oh, but I didn't mean that. It's not so very private, you see. Atlantic, 11751, please.
Sure this isn't personal?
Oh, no, you see. Hello, the 50 Market? Mr. Marks? Uh-huh. Well, this is Susan Wayne. Yeah. Listen, will you please send some things up to my mother at once? £5 of flour. Uh-huh. And £5 of sugar. £1 of coffee, the best. And 6 eggs. No, a dozen eggs. And 2 pounds of butter. No, 1 pound. I mustn't spend too much.
The salary will be $30.
$30? 6 cans of sardines. Yeah, uh-huh. And a 1/2 pound of chocolate and a few frankfurters. The big ones? Well, I...
Yes, the biggest.
Yes, the biggest. And would you kindly tell my mother to get dinner ready? What? Oh, no. I couldn't afford a chicken.
I was wrong. I mean, the salary will be $40.
Yes, Mr. March. Yes, a chicken. A big one. A fat one. And please tell my mother that I have a job. A wonderful job. And tonight she shall have dinner. And what a dinner. Tell her to cook everything. I want it all at once. And oh, Mr. Marks, I just got a wonderful job. A wonderful job.
Three weeks have passed and Susie got her job. And Skylar Thompson's business has taken him... with the efficient Susie to Paris, where he's trying to negotiate a big oil merger. But Dolly Fry, Schuyler's former secretary, is also in Paris and has been trying to see him. She finally calls in person at the luxurious hotel suite, which serves Schuyler and his office staff for both business and living quarters in Paris.
Is this Mr. Schuyler Thompson's suite?
Yes. What is it you wish? I'm his secretary.
My name is Dolly Fry. I want to see Mr. Thompson.
Did you have an appointment?
No.
Oh, well, Mr. Thompson never sees anyone without an appointment.
My dear, I know all those answers so well. You see, I used to be Mr. Thompson's secretary myself.
You?
Mm-hmm. Tell me, not officially, when do you expect Mr. Thompson?
Unofficially and truthfully and finally, I haven't the slightest idea.
Listen, I've left my number with you 6 times. And...
Mr. Thompson is here on business. He has no time for women. I know what you want. You want to come back to the bank.
Oh, you're wrong, my dear. The bank wants to come back to me.
Oh, you talk about Mr. Thompson as if he were a clerk.
As if you knew what kind of a man he is. You have an idea he's all brain and business. Don't you think his heart beats faster when I lean against him by accident?
By accident?
By intentional accident. And how men love it.
Really?
Do they? It's like this. A quick movement, you brush against him, you pull back, you say, oh, pardon me. He murmurs something.
I wonder.
The air is charged with electricity. He struggles for his self-control. And just as he almost has it,
yes?
You start all over again. Then his arms begin to ache to hold you. They steal around you. And if you're a smart girl, you say, no, You must. And then he stopped? Stopped? Of course he doesn't stop. He goes on. He pulls you closer. You struggle, but not much.
And what does he say?
Oh, it doesn't matter. You don't care. His arms tighten. You get dizzy. His eyes look into yours.
Oh, his eyes.
His lips come closer.
His lips.
Your eyelashes flutter down.
You see nothing.
All you know is the wonderful strength of his embrace.
And then?
He kisses.
Oh, how you tell it. I almost lived it.
You? You never will. Of course, you're not bad looking yourself. Only I'm afraid you're just a machine, my dear.
Well, even that would be better than to be like you. All you think of is lovemaking.
That might be enough for him.
I suppose you'll win, but it won't last. Even if you get him, you can't hold him.
You think you could?
I've never tried. I wouldn't want to like that.
Why don't you? It'd probably amuse him. Well, I must be running along now. Will you promise to tell Mr. Thompson I called?
I have my orders to use my own judgment about visitors and to keep any undesirable ones away.
What a child you are. Goodbye, my dear.
Goodbye.
But when Schuyler Thompson comes in, Susie does not tell him about Dolly. He has completed his merger. And in the excitement of taking charge of everything, Susie forgets Dolly completely. But the undiscourageable Dolly finally gets Schuyler on the telephone. He is delighted to hear from her and correspondingly angry with Susie for keeping them apart. I will always see Miss Fry, he tells Susie. I'm going to see her at 9 o'clock this evening. In the future, I wish you would let old Mr. Jackson handle my appointments. But when Schuyler sees how his little secretary is crushed by this ultimatum, he relents a little and tells her he has planned a party for her. His brother Frank and Major Dunbar, an old family friend, are to call for her and take her out to show her Paris. And so Susie hurries to her room to dress in a Paris evening gown and then hurries out to the office to try its effect on Mr. Jackson, Schuyler's confidential clerk, who is still busy at his desk.
Ooh. Mr. Jackson?
Yes, Susie?
Aren't you going to look at my new dress?
Oh, yes. Why, Susie, how lovely you... Why, you look just like a princess.
And not a machine? Oh, thank you, Mr. Jackson. That was just what I needed.
Susie, what are we going to do with all the people who want to call on Mr. Thompson and congratulate him on his merger? Some of them are very important, and they're waiting already. The Count von Falsberg and Monsieur Pichon and Monsieur
Kinsey. Well, Mr. Thompson told me very specially that he doesn't want people kept away from him, and that you were to make his appointment.
Yes, I know, but he's going out this evening, isn't he?
I believe he has one engagement. Oh, but surely nothing as important as these gentlemen. Why don't you arrange it like this? The Count von Walsberg at 8:30, Monsieur Pichon, Monsieur Clichy at 9 o'clock.
At 9.
Mm-hmm. And the gentleman of the press at 9:30, the committee from the Bourse at 10, and so on as requested until 11.
But the Minister of Finance also wishes an hour.
Oh, by all means. From 11 until 12.
Of course. I'll make the arrangements.
Be sure that you do. Oh, Mr. Jackson, I feel just like going out.
Eh?
I feel so much happier now that Mr. Thompson's evening is so beautifully planned.
Yes, well, I expect I'd better go and see the hotel manager about showing these people up to the office. Yes.
That must be Mr. Frank to take me to dinner. Will you see Mr. Jackson?
Oh, certainly.
Jackson, is Miss Wayne a... Susie, how charming you look.
Thank you, Mr. Frank.
Well, I hardly know you, but I'm forgetting my manners. I want you to meet Major Dunbar. He's an old family friend and an expert on Paris. Susie, I think we can count on a large evening.
My dear, I'm honored to have the company of such an exquisite lady.
Oh, you're both so kind. And I'm so very excited. You know, I'm having my first Paris adventure, Major Dunbar.
No.
In fact, my first adventure anywhere.
Well.
You won't mind if I can't keep my excitement to myself?
Well, of course not.
Think, I have two escorts.
Susie.
Oh, Mr. Frank. Flowers for me?
Mm-hmm. From both of us. Isn't she a vision, Major Dunbar?
Oh, no, you're more than kind. Do you really think that anyone would notice me?
Even a blind man. You're adorable, my dear. And now, may we whisk you away?
I'm sorry, but I have a message I must give Mr. Thompson before I go out. Oh. Just a little business. Will you wait for me in the lounge?
Oh, thank you.
Oh, I'm so excited. You know, I think...
think I'm a little in love with you both.
Careful, Miss Wayne, or you'll have a duel on your hands.
Hurry along, Susie. Don't keep us waiting too long.
As her escorts depart, Susie glances quickly around the empty office, listens for a moment in the direction of Skylar Thompson's bedroom door, and then walks to a mirror hanging on the opposite wall. She climbs up on a chair, looks at her feet and ankles in the glass. Suddenly, she hears a sound from Thompson's bedroom and jumps quickly to the floor.
What? Why, Susie?
Oh, Mr. Thompson. Mr. Thompson, I want to apologize for not letting Miss Fry see you today.
Who? Oh, well, let's forget about that. But, Susie, is this the new evening gown?
Yes. Do you like it?
It's very effective. Very. How it changes you. And those pretty round little arms. Why haven't I ever noticed them?
Oh, they've always been covered before.
Do they feel as smooth as they look?
Oh, I don't know.
I wish you weren't going out.
You yourself asked Mr. Frank to take me.
Yeah, so I did. What a fool I am sometimes. Susie, come over here by the window. I want to show you Paris. She's beautiful in the moonlight.
Paris is singing, isn't it? What does a city sing about?
On a night like this, it must be a love song.
I suppose so. Oh, pardon me for brushing against you. It was an accident.
Don't apologize. It was delightful.
Oh.
Susie, dear.
Oh, no, you mustn't. I feel so dizzy.
You darling.
Did you really mean that?
I'll show you whether I mean it.
Oh, no, Mr.
Please,
Thompson.
Please.
Oh, no, please. You mustn't. You frightened me. Let me go. I didn't mean it. I didn't.
There's nothing to be afraid of. Please, dear.
Oh, no, you don't understand. I'm so ashamed.
Dear little girl, why should you be ashamed? You haven't done anything.
Oh, yes, I have. It was all my fault. I'm to blame for it all.
You're to blame for my trying to kiss you?
Yes. She said I was just a machine and no man would ever notice me. So I tried it, just as she says she does. I leaned against you accidentally. I protested. I got dizzy. I closed my eyes. I almost got kissed.
What? Why, you little devil, who told you all this?
Dolly Fry.
Experimenting with Dolly's room. You little imp.
Oh, I hate myself. It's so cheap, so common. I should think you despise me.
I adore you.
Oh, no. You never thought of me as a woman until I made you do it.
But women always open men's eyes.
Well, I don't. I'm not satisfied to sneak into a man's arms and be kissed just because I happen to be there. That's too easy for him. I want a man to climb mountains just to get to me. I want him to pass by all the other women and kick down a door to kiss me.
Susie.
When I love a man, he must ache and long for me. Only me. He must be hungry and thirsty forever unless I come along. I, Susie Wayne, no other woman on earth will do. That's the sort of love I want.
I'll show you what. Now, who the devil is that? Oh, Frank.
What's keeping you, Susie?
Oh, hello, Skylar.
Oh. Hello, Skylar. Can you join us?
Yes, Major. I think I will.
Oh, no, you can't. You have an important engagement with a lady at 9:00.
Huh? Oh, that. Well, I'll break it.
Of course. But you have a lot of other engagements, too. Look, here's your calendar. At 8:30, the Count von Waldburg. At 9, Monsieur Pinchot, Monsieur Clichy. My, you'll be awfully busy at 9. At 9:30, the gentleman of the press, and at 10...
Now, what the devil is this? Who made all these appointments for me?
Why, you told me you didn't want people kept away from you.
Why, you know...
Let's get started, Susie. Have a good time, Skylar.
Yeah. Yes, have a pleasant evening, Mr. Thompson.
Cheerio, Skylar.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Well, I'll be damned.
It's 3:00 in the morning, and Skylar Thompson has had an extremely disagreeable evening. Since the last of his official interviews ended at midnight, he has done nothing but fidget, glancing frequently out of the window at one end of the room, which overlooks the street. It has not been the night of celebration which he planned.
Hello. Oh, hello, Dolly. I know a lot of things came up, and I just didn't get a chance to call you. No, no, it's too late now. It's the third. No. I've got a big job still ahead of me before the night's over. Goodbye. Oh, come in. Come in. Well, Major.
Hello.
What in the world have you been doing all this time? Where the devil is Susie?
With Frank. I had to stop. I couldn't keep up with them. I'm getting old, I'm afraid.
Well, where is she now? Where did you take her?
Oh, everywhere. Cafe after cafe. She danced. She sang. She was wild with excitement. And then we drove in the Bois in one of those open cabs. She jumped out and dared Frank and me to race with her. Like an elf, she started to run and Frank after her. Of course, I was left behind.
Well, when was this?
Oh, hours ago.
Hmm. Susie alone with Frank in the Bois. Mm-hmm. You should be ashamed of yourself. Why in the name of... Oh, come in. Oh, Frank. Well, where's Susie? Isn't she with you?
She ran away from me. I've been looking for her ever since. I thought she'd be here.
A fine pair of cavaliers. Leave a girl like that alone in Paris. I don't think she has a penny either.
Well, she didn't need her.
Now, both of you go and find her and bring her back at once. Each of you take a taxi. Drive through the Bois from different entrances. Now, will you go? Will you get out?
Oh, all right, Skylar. Don't worry.
Worry?
No, no, no. Keep calm, old
man. I am calm! I am! Now, get out of here. Hurry up. Go on, both of you. Good Lord, you idiots. Oh, I wonder where Susie can be.
Mr. Thompson?
Susie! Where on earth have you been? Heavens, I've been terribly worried, Susie.
I've been in my room since a little after midnight.
Oh.
I tried to write to my mother, but I couldn't. You know, I think Paris has gone a little to my head.
To mine, too. Susie, how do you feel now?
Excited. Wonderful. I feel so free. It was marvelous in the Bois. The moon was shining, and all around were the woods, dark and mysterious. But the lovers there, with their whisperings and their kisses, I couldn't bear them. I had to come back.
So tonight you thought of love, perhaps for the first time. Is that it, little mouse?
Until now, I've known only the hunger for food. The delicatessen windows held all I wanted. But now I'm well fed, and I'm still unsatisfied, for I know that I really have nothing.
What do you want, Susie?
Oh, something beautiful. Something I can see through the window of life. At first, I thought I only wanted to look on. But that isn't enough. I want to be in it. I want to be of it.
You're finally awake, Susie. You see ahead of you a new world. A world full of unexpected joys. It needs only one word. One step. One kiss.
One word. One kiss.
Susie, you know that you have lovely feet and ankles.
Oh.
And wonderful eyes, so deep that a man could drown in them. And what a mouth. Will you take a telegram, Miss Wayne?
Why, certainly. Ready?
Well, a dear child.
Dear child.
You'll never know what a struggle it's been for me to act as I have. Comma. But I wanted to be quite sure before I told you what was in my heart. Stop.
In my heart? Stop.
Forgive me for not telling you openly and honorably, comma.
Faster.
For not saying at once, I love you. Stop. And now the address.
Please, the address very slowly. Spell it out.
Miss C-H-U-R-C-H-M-O-U-S-E.
Oh.
Oh, my sweet.
Oh.
What comes now, darling?
Stop. Stop. Ooh. Stop.
This program is sponsored by the makers of Royal Desserts, who a little over a year ago asked American housewives to make a simple test, merely to smell their gelatin desserts as they added the hot water, and then to make the same test with Royal Gelatin. Many women who tried this test were amazed at the difference. At once, there was a big demand for Royal Gelatin. Women told each other about its delightful fragrance, its aroma of fresh fruit. And Royal Gelatin became so tremendously popular that within the past year, the sale of Royal Gelatin has more than doubled. If you have not already made this test, try
try it the next time you make a gelatin dessert. Add the hot water, then smell the rising vapor. With Royal Gelatin, you'll never get a trace of unpleasantness. Just the delicious fragrance of real, fresh fruit. Strawberry, cherry, or pineapple, lemon, lime, or orange. Try several different flavors of Royal Gelatin. Get some tomorrow. Next week, Mary Pickford will be back again on this program in another great play. She wants to tell you about it herself. Miss Pickford.
Friends, next week we are planning to present Coquette, which you may remember was my first talking picture. We've already started rehearsals, and I'm happy to say Johnny Mac Brown is playing the hero, as he did with me on the screen. I hope you'll all be listening in for next Wednesday evening. And until then, good night, and God go with you.
From 1934, The Church Mouse, starring Mary Pickford. You've been listening to When Radio Ruled, podcast number 5, the year 1934. Featured songs of the era were
You're Sensational,
performed live by Lillian Kamen on the Fleshman's Yeast Hour, August 23, 1934. You're the Top, performed live by Cole Porter on the Fleshman's Yeast Hour, December 13, 1934.
Mandy, there's a minister handy, and it sure would be dandy if we let him make a fee.
Mandy, Eddie Cantor, 1934.
What do you go for? Go see a show for, tell the truth, you go to see those beautiful dames.
Those Beautiful Dames, performed live by Rudy Valley on the Fleshman's Yeast Hour, August 23, 1934.
Oh, dames, a temporary flame to you.
You love me someday, so why not now?
You'll Love Me Someday, So Why Not Now? Performed live by Rudy Valley on the Fleshman's Yeast Hour, December 27, 1934. I'm your host, Mike Gillett. You've also heard from the cast of the Fleshman's Yeast Hour, Rudy Valley, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the cast of The March of Time, the cast of The Hour of Smiles, Fred Allen, the cast of The Jack Benny Chevrolet Show, the cast of The Jack Benny Jell-O Show, Milton Berle, George Burns and Gracie Allen, Portland Hoffa, Mary Livingston, B.B. Daniels and Ben Lyon, and the cast of the Mary Pickford Dramas production of The Church Mouse. Special thanks to archive.org, otr.net, grimripper2u@yahoo.com, and lots of kindred spirits all over the internet. One last note, the Lone Ranger theme was from 1942, not from 1934. I couldn't find one of the original 1934 Lone Ranger episodes. All other radio clips, movie soundtrack excerpts, and music were recorded in 1934. I'm Mike Gillett, writer and producer. When Radio Ruled is a Before TV production. Copyright 2016.
Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, on April the 4th, the makers of IPANA will announce on this program, The Hour of Smiles, complete details of a dental charm contest open to every girl and young woman in the United States. Three winners will receive free trips to the Chicago World's Fair. Winner of first prize will be the official dental charm girl of the Century of Progress, 1934.
Don't keep me waiting.